Hello learners, today we are going to be talking about Gandhi's Ashrams, Seedbeds of Ecological Development. This is Unit 13 of the course MGPE 14 and I'm Dr. Shubhangi Vaidya from the School of Interdisciplinary and Transdisciplinary Studies at IGNO. We have divided this particular unit in two parts because there is a lot of very, very rich information and very, very interesting points for discussion which we feel need to be covered in more detail. So the aims and objectives of this particular talk are to understand the concept of ashram life as propagated by Mahatma Gandhi. It is also to visualize the harmonious relation between humans and nature. And it is also to discuss Gandhi's advocacy of ashram life and his experiments with the same. As I've mentioned, we will cover this over two sessions. Let's begin by trying to understand the importance of ashrams in Gandhi's philosophy. In previous lectures also, we have spoken in brief about ashrams, the various experiments that Gandhi conducted at ashrams. But these particular lectures are meant to plumb these details in a more comprehensive way. In his work on Gandhi and his ashrams, Mark Thompson observes that Gandhi's ashrams and his advocacy for an ashram life were unique. They were the seedbeds of Gandhi's communitarian ideals and experimentation. They emphasized community life and brotherhood, which were really the watchwords of what ashrams, as per Gandhi, were all about. And Gandhi also believed that the ashrams were actually his finest achievements. They were really the laboratories in which he could actualize many of his ideas and fine-tune many of his practices. As you're very familiar, John Ruskin's famous book, Unto This Last, had a major influence on Gandhi, and this was repeatedly acknowledged by Gandhi. In fact, the entire notion of Sarvodaya derives or draws upon the principles that were enshrined in Ruskin's work. Gandhi's emphasis was on understanding and inspiring brotherhood, a feeling of unity amongst one and all, such that all of us or all human beings would work together in cooperation to sustain, to help, to support each other, rather than be in a state of unhealthy competition, which was what has led really to the world being virtually on the brink of extinction. Some of the noted experiments or some of the noted ashram-like experiments that Gandhi did were the Phoenix Settlement and Tolstoy Farm in South Africa, Sabarmati Ashram, which is very well known in India. All these are reflections of his ways of thinking, living, and advocating harmony between human beings and nature. So the important thing to note is that human beings and nature are in a harmonious relationship rather than in a relationship of domination and subordination. Ashrams have been conceptualized as centers of community living. As per Hindu philosophy, an ashram is a place where one may live peacefully and wholesomely, free of wants, desires, and through adoption of self-discipline and self-purification. Many of you would have known about or would have heard about the various ancient ashrams that we read about in our folklore, in our legends, in our history, where in the forest, people lived together in a very, very organic way, at one with nature, and trying their best to purify themselves of their desires, of their baser instincts. The concepts of Grihastha Ashram and Vanaprastha Ashram remain very important elements in the Hindu way of life, wherein Grihastha Ashram, when a person leads a life of a householder and devotes himself or herself to performing the duties of a householder. Later on, when these duties are performed, the individual can then devote their lives to activities that are designed to help society as a whole, the community as a whole. Residents should involve themselves in positive activities that benefit society. They should think good thoughts, speak good words, and do deeds that would help them to navigate themselves towards the ultimate goal of moksha or liberation from the worldly bonds. So ashram life is also seen as one of the stages in the organic path towards finding freedom, towards finding release from the material bonds of the world. Ashrams was considered as the seed beds to foster a harmonious coexistence between human beings and also between human beings and nature. Nature has always been revered or worshipped in Hindu philosophy, and the ashrams are generally regarded as the settlements that are closest to nature with an eco-friendly approach towards life. Let's look at some of the activities in the Gandhi ashram that were really in tune with these goals of universal brotherhood, harmony between human beings, and harmony between human beings and nature. So in these ashram, we find promoting agricultural practices, growing vegetables, conserving resources like water, and the production of what we call organic goods. These were the activities that were undertaken in a big way. Collective or group prayers, religious discourses, education, academic and creative, encouraging of craftsmanship, and imparting of vocational education were also activities designed to enhance individual creativity. All these activities, as I've just mentioned, not just encourage or enhance individual talent, but they also help to protect and conserve nature and make the individuals realize the importance of natural resources and the importance of living in harmony with nature, cultivating the feeling of oneness towards all living beings. Ashrams thus served the purpose of social and collective welfare of all living beings and developed a feeling of reverence towards all creation. To quote Mark Thompson, who has written about Gandhi's experiments with ashrams, I quote, "The ashrams Gandhi established served as laboratories where he and his colleagues experimented with non-violence as an alternative way of life. In these small monastic communities of men and women, living according to absolute vows, he sought to lay the groundwork for an egalitarian social organization and economy, and to develop an education system that reflected the Indian genius. The ashrams provided economic and moral support, as well as fostering the discipline and awareness necessary for their members to sustain grassroots civil disobedience. Gandhi saw the need in the tradition-bound, rigidly hierarchical Indian society for a moral sanction, able to inspire people to help themselves. He believed ashramic life, based on mutuality, simplicity, and hard work, would nurture an asceticism that could be channeled through positive action to reform society." Unquote. So many important ideas can be found in these words. We find that the ashrams were not just a way of Gandhi to try out his social and economic experiments, but also to create the discipline and to create a certain climate which would enable individuals, which would enable the community to take on the colonial rule as well. And because of the hard work, because of the simplicity, because of the kind of asceticism that was nurtured in these ashrams, a spirit of discipline, a spirit of wanting to work for the liberation of the country and for the betterment of the nation as a whole would be fostered in these organizations or in these associations. Gandhi's ideas of ashram life thoroughly relied on his strict vows of vegetarianism and his religious outlook. The work of the famous Russian writer Leo Tolstoy also greatly influenced Gandhi. Tolstoy had repudiated the state and the church for, in quotes, a truly religious society sustained by vegetarianism, celibacy, and other forms of self-control. And his ideas on small experimental communities coincided in a sense with Indian values of ashram life. So Gandhi, you see, drew on various sources for his ideas of the ashram. Of course, the fundamental idea was the Hindu notion of the ashram as being a place where individuals perfected their moral and their spiritual selves. At the same time, the work of Tolstoy also had played a very, very profound role in Gandhi's thinking. In his lifetime, Gandhi established a few ashrams, notably amongst them the Phoenix Settlement and the Tolstoy Farm in South Africa, and Sabarmati or the Satyagraha Ashram, and Sevagram, about which we know much more. While the first two came up at the backdrop of his struggles in South Africa, the other two were set up against the backdrop of the Indian national movement and proved to be very, very important sites where many, many important activities, many, many important decisions pertaining to the national movement were taken. Two important aspects that Gandhi insisted upon were the purity of the body and mind and economic equality. We've discussed this notion of economic equality in our earlier lectures on Sarvodaya and Antyodaya. Even in the Tolstoy farm, Gandhi attempted to practice his doctrine by leading a life of utmost simplicity. Phoenix and Tolstoy farms became important Satyagraha institutions where Gandhi's ways, his entire political strategy really perfected itself. He made common kitchen and prayers as a main tool of community living, which would enable people to come together and to share their experiences. According to Mark Thompson, it was in an order of Trappist monks living at Mariam Hill near Pinetown, 16 miles from Durban in South Africa, that provided Gandhi with a functioning example of a micro-community living on the basis of voluntary poverty, self-renunciation, and constructive work. And all these are eco-friendly methods in themselves, as you would realize. The Trappist settlement, in a sense, became the inspiring point for Gandhi. He was deeply impressed by the strict vows of silence and chastity and patterns of simplicity, virtue, and gentleness. Probably the idea of giving training in various workshops originated from here. These workshops were undertaken to train people as blacksmiths, tinsmiths, shoemakers, carpenters, and tanners, while women were trained in ironing, sewing, straw hat manufacturing, and knitting. The printing press, oil press, and flour mill were all part of these settlements. Once again, recall Gandhi's fascination for bread labor, for working using one's hands, for actually creating the goods that are required for consumption. So these all find a reflection in the ashram way of life. Similarly, in India, Gandhi established the Satyagraha Ashram, more famously known as the Sabarmati Ashram, in 1915, originally at Kochrab. It was later moved to Sabarmati near Ahmedabad. As Gandhi said, the object of this ashram is that its members should qualify themselves for and make a constant endeavor towards the service of the country, not inconsistent with the universal welfare. So in a sense, the ashrams were centers training a cadre of devoted, of dedicated individuals who would serve the community. Let's look at some of the important values or principles of ashram life propagated by Gandhi. Truth, of course, this was a cardinal faith with Gandhi. Non-violence or love. Chastity or brahmacharya. Control of the palate, in other words, control over the taste, control over what one eats. Non-stealing, non-possession or poverty, physical labor, swadeshi, fearlessness, removal of untouchability, and tolerance. All these, in a sense, are universal values, and the need for these values remains so strong even to this day. What were some of these activities that emanated as a result of the embracing these values? So you have worship. We all know that community or group worship was an integral feature of Gandhi's ashram. Sanitary service, that is cleaning the sanitary facilities, the toilets and so on. sacrificial spinning. That is, spinning or working on the charkha was seen as a way of sacrifice, not something to gain from it, but rather as a kind of an activity that would promote spiritual upliftment. Agriculture, dairy, tannery, national education, Khadi Technical School. So all these activities really were in tune with the very idea of Swadeshi, the idea of self-reliance, the idea of relying upon the indigenous genius towards a route or towards a path wherein we would all be interdependent and self-dependent. Gandhi emphasized the activities particularly related to spinning and khadi work. You are all very familiar with the great emphasis that Gandhi placed on the charkha, and how the charkha was not just a tool, was not just an implement for producing cloth, but in a sense it symbolized many of the core values of the national movement and Gandhi's own value system. These activities were done to supplement the income, as also to encourage the cloth production indigenous in nature. You all know that it is basically in providing for the factory manufactured cloth that the entire Indian indigenous industry was destroyed by the colonial power. There were also experiments related to agriculture, and labor was hired to tend to the crops. As this ashram set the precedent, the example really all over the country, many people came forward to set up similar ashrams. Some of the well-known ones include Jagat Ram Dave's ashram in Bedchi, Vallabhai Patel's ashram in Bardoli, J.B. Kriplani's Gandhi ashram in Banaras, and Vinoba Bhave's Satyagraha ashram in Wardha. Let's discuss now some of the healthy practices promoted by Gandhi. And as we discuss them, you will find out how relevant they are to the contemporary times also, how simple and yet how profound. So he recommended daily spinning so as to ensure manual labor and the spirit of Swadeshi, in a way keeping oneself rooted to the realities of the country and the society. Avoiding sitting idle or talking loudly so that peace may prevail. We find that we are in the habit very often of talking at the tops of our voices and really creating an atmosphere that is not at all congenial to peace and non-violence. Adoption of a simple lifestyle and avoiding unnecessary wastage. Once again, a very, very important idea in this age of untrammeled consumption and consumerism. Treat one and all with courtesy and be considerate to all. Once again, a very, very important value in societies where there are so many differences between castes, classes, genders, and so on, and where there is a sense of some people dominating, a small group of people dominating over the others and treating them in a sense as less than human. Regarding food, he recommended that food must be taken like medicine, under proper restraint only, for sustaining the body and keeping it a fit instrument for service. We find that in the contemporary times, food has become a kind of fetish. Food is being consumed just for its own sake, for the sheer pleasure of consuming food. However, Gandhi emphasized the value of treating food as something that must strictly be consumed only to keep the body in a state of health and not becoming something that individuals are addicted to or obsessed with. Bad or imperfectly cooked food should not be eaten. Once again, also remember Gandhi's strong emphasis on vegetarianism. He recommended not having more clothes than strictly necessary, wear khadi, and use village-made products. Everything must be kept in its proper place. All refuse must be put into the dustbin. Water must not be wasted. Boiled water should be used for drinking purposes, and pots and pans are fully washed or finally washed with boiled water. Unboiled water of the ashram wells is not safe to drink. We should not spit or clean the nose on the road, but only in an out-of-the-way place where no one is likely to walk. This is such an important principle of hygiene, which we find being flouted all the time. Hands should be washed with utmost cleanliness after using toilets so as to avoid unhygienic practices. Twigs should be used to clean teeth, and these should not be thrown away after use. They should be collected in a pot. Waste paper, which cannot be used for writing on the other side, should be burned. Nothing else should be mixed with it. Fragments of the vegetables must be kept separate and converted into manure. Broken glass should be thrown into a pit at a safe distance from houses. We find that these practices, which may seem very, very simple and day-to-day, actually contain profound truths. They include the values of respecting the health and safety of others, respecting the environment, of ensuring that wasteful consumption is not undertaken, and are completely in sync with maintaining or conserving nature, and also conserving a kind of a human life which is filled with quality, which is filled with productivity. To conclude, in this lecture, we've discussed the philosophical foundations and day-to-day practices of ashram life as propagated by Gandhi, which, as we have seen, drew from both Eastern and Western ascetic traditions, and the belief in a life of service, community living, and universal brotherhood. In the second part, we shall discuss in detail more aspects of ashram life as propagated and as practiced by Gandhi. Thank you.